Thank you. Thank you, Anna. And thank you for the chance, opportunity, this chance for you to give me that chance to get back to the hospital, be with her, and for ranking Guthrie. I appreciate it. Look, we all know there's a need for drug pricing reform. I don't think there's any one of us would be arguing against that. But pursuing this highly partisan HR 3 is just an example of overreach, unfortunate overreach. It occurs too often in Washington, and it gets in the way. All the political observers that I've read about in Washington in the press are saying that HR 3 is not going to pass the Senate. So I've got to say, fundamentally, I understand, why are we doing this? Why are we working together to try to pass something that can be signed into law? There are bipartisan solutions that were included in H.R. 19. So unless we change the course, this projection of this legislation, we know how the story's going to pan out. We've seen it before in immigration. We're about to see it in the infrastructure bill again, overreach on that. And we're seeing it now in this drug pricing. These are all bipartisan issues that we would all work together on if we focused on what we need to get done. Focus on those. But that's not what's happening with this. Look, we were here to get solutions to it, and I really want to get to it. HR 3, unfortunately, is an overreach. Unfortunately, it gives me the impression for those in the public that Congress is seemingly willing to let American patients suffer. This is a high-stakes political game we're into right now, and if the Senate doesn't pass it and it doesn't get to the president's desk for signature, the American public is going to suffer. I think they deserve better. H.R. 19 includes caps for insulin deductibles. It passes on rebates directly to state Medicaid programs, ensuring that PBMs do not profit off government programs. And it makes it unlawful for pay-for-delay practices, whereby drug companies enter agreements with generics and biosimilar manufacturers to delay a competing drug coming to market. These are all obvious. These are just a sampling of the 40 bipartisan bills that we already passed out of our committee. So we know that the loser here is going to be the American public if we don't get a bill to the president's desk for signature. So I want it with my question is, now we know that utilizing generic medications is one of the best way to lower drug pricing, but PBMs and Part D program plans are not covering generics. So, and this practice costs seniors $4 billion. Insurance have $4 billion annually. So, Ms. Sachs, in your testimony, you discussed some of these issues about the formulary design in Part D. The current system incentivizes placement of higher cost drug brand prices over generics. And the bill that I'm working with Kuster about, 2846, addresses this issue by ensuring would lower the price. Can you speak more to this issue of formulary design and how the current trend is leading to increased costs for patients rather than lowering?
Yes, absolutely. So without going too far into the details of the Part D benefit design, as this committee is well aware, the current incentives, unfortunately, may lead both manufacturers and PBMs and plans to increase or drive up prices over time rather than to reduce them. And so the Part D redesign elements in HR 3 and also in HR 19 are important for minimizing some of those incentives. However, they only work where there are generic or biosimilar opportunities available for patients. And in many of these cases, there are not. So in my testimony, I also give the example of a drug like Humira, which was first approved in 2002 and has lively biosimilar competition in Europe, but where we still have no competition today and won't for another 2 years. Yet it's one of the top 10 selling drugs in Part D. The idea that we would negotiate the price of a drug like Humira and be able to obtain better prices for patients and our payers is at the heart of HR 3, but it's not part of HR 19.
If I could get back, I want to ask a last question to Dr. Gupta, because the United States, we're still, across this country, still experiencing a wave of drug overdoses at a higher rate than we've ever seen before. So my question, Dr., how would HR 3 affect the price and discovery of new non-addictive pain medication and treatment assisted medically assisted treatments. How would HR 3 affect that? Can you share some of your thoughts?
Thank you, Congressman. Yes. So I think the need for developing non-opiate, non-addicting pain medications is one that the entire biopharma industry is working hard to tackle. You know, we're aware of both the need for treating pain, but also the need of creating alternatives to opiates. It's early stages still. There's several things in development that we don't know if they're going to work yet. And I would caution that price controls, which, by the way, you know, don't ensure that we'll be passing savings directly onto patients, would really put a lot of that work at risk.
Okay, thank you. I've my time's expired, and I just want to say, Anna and Britt, thank you. I want to be with my wife. So God bless.
Absolutely. And we